Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the fabulous state of South Carolina. Hope you guys are doing all right. I wanted to make a couple different videos. Right. Anyway, first I got another bottle of olive oil here. Praise the Lord for that. And what I want to do is I've already used up the other one, and I'll be sending some more out tomorrow. Today's Veterans Day, of course. So the post office was closed today, brothers and sisters, and then of course, I wasn't going to mention it, but just, you know, we asked for prayers for all veterans. You know, myself, I'm a veteran. I was there in the Gulf War in Iraq. As a matter of fact, I went to Ur of the Chaldees, and I posted the pictures on Facebook before. I actually went to the house that's supposed to be where Abraham was born, and have a piece of pottery from off the ground there. There's a billion pieces of busted pottery all over the place. There in Ur of the Chaldees there. So praise the Lord for that opportunity to go there. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to pray for this olive oil, a new batch. I just made a video, the last video, explaining about the olive oil and how to use it. I can't go through that in all videos, brothers and sisters. If you go back one video before this on my channel, you can see it. Anyway, so I have praise reports coming in. People using oil and being instantly healed. So praise God for that. For His Holy Spirit power, for my prayers and your prayers. As the Bible says, the fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. James chapter 5. And it says, if there's any sick among you, call him for the, you know, let him call for the elders of the church, anointing them with the oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall heal the sick. Brothers and sisters, this oil, as we pray our faith on it, the elders, us, you know, who are elders in the body of Christ, and all of you guys, some of you are elders, some of you are not, it doesn't matter. We're going to pray over this oil, bless it, and then as if we are all there praying in agreement with the person who's applying the oil and praying for healings, for deliverances, for anything you can think of, anointing a house, for exorcism, all those things, we come in agreement and we just release the anointing into this oil. Our prayers are in this oil, and when it's applied, as I said, it's a point of contact that we've touched it. Those people there who apply it, all of our prayers are coming in agreement with them. So we are, the Lord gave me the idea for this oil, and what it's doing is putting the power of agreement of all of us is symbolized in this oil as a point of contact and a point of agreement. So the Bible says one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. Start multiplying that times 200 or 300 or 400 or 500 people that would pray in agreement over this oil, as if 400 or 500 people are praying for your situation, whether it be sickness, disease, salvation of a loved one, you know, casting, you know, demonization in somebody's house, any kind of thing you can think of. So let's pray in agreement right now, brothers and sisters, right now. Right now, Father, we come in agreement in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God, and I speak favor. The Lord just spoke to me when I was speaking a minute ago that this anointing oil, that it be filled with His favor, that whomever has this anointing oil applied to them will be walking in the favor of God. Hallelujah. Unearned, unmerited favor. Hallelujah. 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 More than grace. Grace is one thing, but favor from the Lord is another thing. God will give you favor even with your enemies. For the Bible says that when a man's ways are pleasing to God, even his enemies are at rest with him. God will give you favor in the city and favor in the country. Favor going in and favor coming out. Favor in the anywhere you are, God will give you favor on your job, favor with medical reports, favor with employment, as I said, favor with evangelizing people, favor with your family, favor, favor, favor. I speak the word, the miracle. The Lord is telling me to say miracle. The miracle of favor be upon everyone and anyone that's anointed with His oil in the name of Jesus, the favor of God. Be upon you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We just come in agreement right now and we speak health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, love, salvation, deliverance, healing, sanctification, glorification, calling, high callings to be released into this anointing oil in Jesus' name. All those things I say and more and 100 times more in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Be in this anointing oil right now. Hallelujah. I will give, the Lord is saying, I will give to you all of this and more. Hallelujah. Praise be God, Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. We release it in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. The power of the Most High God. You shall receive power from on high when the Holy Spirit has come upon you to be a witness to me, Jesus said. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Here in Judea, to Samaria, and to the othermost parts of the world. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, there's power in this oil. The Lord is releasing the Holy Spirit power. This anointing oil also represents, of course, the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. When this, you would put this oil upon you, the Holy Spirit would come upon you in power. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. There's many of you who are seeking to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Right now, this is a point of contact. I speak it under the what the Lord is telling me to say. In Jesus' name. Brothers and sisters, I was going to pray for this oil just like I did last time. But the Lord is speaking to me. That's power. And the oil I've already sent out, and the oil I'm going to send out tomorrow, and then all the oil. God is above space, time, and all those things. He's beyond the space, time continuum. He is beyond back to the future. And past, present, and future, and all of those things, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. God is our flux capacitor to go above and beyond all things in space and time, brothers and sisters. And so if you already received anointing oil from me that the Lord has got led me to send out, and you've already received it, that power is in there. If you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, brothers and sisters, this boldness that I'm speaking in has come from the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of God is on you in Jesus' name right now. Okay, Lord. You know, the Lord always surprises me. So I'm going to pray right now. The Lord is speaking to me to tell you that the power of God is upon you in Jesus' name. Right now I speak power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. That the power of the living God be upon you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I speak. Hallelujah. The power of the Most High God come upon you to be a witness for Him. Hallelujah. In the uttermost parts of the world. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I speak power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. I see somebody, a particular brother. You know, God is doing something new. He will do something new today. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works it out in His own way. He will make a way for you and me. He will make a way. Rivers in the desert will I see. Hallelujah. Heaven and earth may change, but His word will still remain. He will do something new today. Hallelujah. God will make a way. Hallelujah. I see a particular brother. Brother Darren in Texas. I see your face. And the Lord says that the power of God, the Spirit of the Lord is upon you right now. And you shall prophesy in my name. Hallelujah. It's a new thing. See, it's a new thing. When Noah built the ark, it was a new thing. Brother Darren and all of you are watching this. It's a new thing. It's not something you've ever experienced before. When God does something, it's a new thing, anew to you, but not new to God. Hallelujah. It's new to you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. God renews our minds with His word, and He renews our spirit with His blood and His Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. It's the blood of Jesus that cleanses us, and then His spirit that renews our spirit. Hallelujah. Even as He says in His word, His spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Romans 8:16. Hallelujah. Praise be God Most High. I'm going to continue to pray. You know, I haven't done the videos of words for people in a long time, brothers and sisters, because I had so many requests and it was just consuming, you know, my time. So I just said, Lord, I'm putting it on the shelf because it's just too much of a demand on my time. But it's still there, brothers and sisters, from the Lord to do that. And it's God's timing, brothers and sisters. To everything there is a season. Turn, to everything there is a season. Hallelujah. Ecclesiastes 3:11. Brothers and sisters, there's a season and a time for all things. Hallelujah. So I speak right now in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father, we praise You. Just wait on You, Lord. I ask you guys to pray in agreement with me, even though you're watching this after I make it. God is our flux capacitor. He is beyond the space-time continuum, brothers and sisters. And I guess I'm saying that, you know, I did get my hair cut. I trimmed it down myself. Actually, I bought some clippers. But, you know, I was going for that doc look. But, you know, I decided to go ahead and clip it down a little bit. Hey, brothers and sisters. Anyway, so... I ask you guys to pray in agreement with me right now that I'll hear from the Lord, because the Lord is moving for me to speak by His Spirit. And brothers and sisters, it's, you know, it's beyond our control. That's why religious people and religious ceremonies, you go to a church, you got the little program, we're going to sing song A, B, C that they planned it 6 months in advance. The preacher's going to preach, you know, 10 steps, you know, to how to be a better parent, or some kind of psychobabble stuff that has nothing to do with the gospel, but to do with the flesh and keeping people in the dark. You know, it's, in the army, we used to call that, mushroom management, you know, keep us in the dark and use fertilizer, you know, put fertilizer on us. But most of the churches practice a mushroom Christianity, you know. They keep you in the dark and then they feed you a bunch of fertilizer, brothers and sisters. You know, when I was praying a little while ago, the Lord had led me about this dream I had about at least 10 years ago, brothers and sisters. I don't know if I've shared it or not. Maybe I did. I think I did a little bit. Anyway, I had this dream, brothers and sisters. And I was going up in this ski lift looking thing to this hotel. It was a great big giant hotel representing the church, you know, the body of Christ. And I was going into that thing and there was a driver there. And some of my relatives were there with me. This is about 2002, 2001 maybe. And I was in this ski lift looking thing, or like an elevator on a cable car thing. And the driver was actually a demon. I could see he was a demon, but nobody else recognized that. All the other people there, nobody knew it. I could see he had these black ear tips and he had black fingernails and all this, but no one else could see it. They thought they were ushers or employees of the hotel. Okay, so in this case, let's just translate it directly. These were preachers, alleged preachers, right? So we get in there, into the hotel, and part of my dream was I got separated from my relatives. One of them was killed in the elevator, all this different stuff separated from me. So, of course, these people, these relatives of mine are not saved. You know, that was part of my dream. But anyway, in my dream, I was in this big lobby, and written across the wall, on every wall, was Acts chapter 4, verse 6. Acts chapter 4, verse 6, everywhere. And of course, I read that text, and I believe what the Lord was telling me is that, you know, that's when the apostles were beaten, and they were told, hey, don't preach in this name. Don't use the name of Jesus. You know, and the apostles said, you know, let's be the judge. Should we obey God or men, you know? And so they continued to pray and minister to people in the name of Jesus and teach in the name of Jesus and healing in the name of Jesus. So that's what they were doing. But all of these people that were Christians, brothers and sisters, were standing at attention. You know, this is Veterans Day. They were standing at attention, standing, you know, these military positions like at ease, parade rest, they called all these different kinds of stuff. And all these lines, they were lined up waiting in the line in front of these windows. And brothers and sisters, I got in there and I knew there were demons that were in charge. And I knew that we didn't have to wait in the line. You could go ahead and go on into the hotel. And all these people were in all these different lines. And then, you know, then that's when I saw that written on each wall, Acts chapter 4, verse 6. And then, you know, the Holy Spirit spoke to me in my dream and said, you know, begin to boldly tell these people, stop standing in these stupid lines, these religious lines. You don't have to obey what these false prophets and these fallen demons are telling you. Get out of these lines and go into the hotel and give them my name and give them the gospel. And I was brand new in the ministry at that time, brothers and sisters. It's like 2001, 2002. And I began to yell and rebuke and call them. And then, you know, like some people woke up and got out of the lines and went into the hotel. But I would say 90% of the people did not get out of line. They stayed in those lines. They believed that they were supposed to stand in a line and to go through all these procedures and all this before they could get into the hotel, brothers and sisters. And that is really the heart of revival, the heart of getting out of the religious spirit, and the heart of the ministry that God gave me to help Him, the Lord, prepare a bride to be without spot or wrinkle. And I want to tell you something, brothers and sisters, guaranteed. That's that's for my friends in Baton Rouge. I guarantee you that you do not need to stand in any religious lines. You do not need to perform any religious ceremonies. You do not have to be in any kind of confirmation classes and indoctrinations and inculcations and whatever kind of a man-made religious spirit that you've been indoctrinated with or been exposed to or been a tradition in your family. I guarantee you do not have to go through that, brothers and sisters. You are free in the name of Jesus Christ. You are free to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. You are free to speak in tongues. Hallelujah. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, it says, forbid not the speaking of tongues, brothers and sisters. Forbid not. You never hear these old religious people talking about that. They always say, oh, we're supposed to have an interpreter. Y'all are supposed to have an interpreter. Okay, where's your interpreter? not rebuking people speaking in tongues. For the word of God says, Paul himself wrote in the same text where he says that you need to have an interpreter if someone speaks in tongues in church, in an open public church meeting, someone speaks in tongues where people can hear it, there needs to be an interpreter. The same Paul said in the same text, forbid not the speaking of tongues. Hallelujah. And it also says, quench not the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. These people quench the Holy Spirit. And the Bible also says, Paul also wrote, grieve not the Holy Spirit. These same Pharisees, these same tares, these same children of the devil have kept you bound long enough. And I say right now, Jesus said, those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. So I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, be thou free in Jesus' name. Be free to be truly born again. Be free to be washed in the blood of Jesus. Be free to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Be free to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Be free to operate in the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5. Brothers and sisters, may the Spirit of the Lord be upon you in Jesus' name. May you be filled with power from on high to be a witness for the Lord. Brothers and sisters, when the apostles were in Jerusalem and they saw the risen Lord, they were born again. When they saw Jesus and they believed, even finally the last apostle, Doubting Thomas, when he saw the risen Lord, he believed. And Jesus said, blessed are those who do not see, but yet believe. And so all the apostles were born again. They were saved. Jesus blew the Holy Spirit on them at the end of the Gospel of John. He said, receive you the Holy Spirit. They were sealed with the Holy Spirit, and they were saved. But were they ready to go out and be witnesses? Were they ready to go out and do their ministry as apostles? No. Jesus said, tarry in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Father, the Holy Spirit shall come upon you, and you shall receive power from on high to be a witness for me in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and all the ends of the earth. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Brothers and sisters, you need to be endowed with power from on high. If the apostles who walked with the risen Christ for 3.5 years and had seen him, they had walked with the Lord throughout his ministry from the time of his baptism with John the Baptist until his resurrection, crucifixion and resurrection. They saw, witnessed all of that. They personally witnessed all of his preaching. They were personally blown on with the Holy Spirit to be sealed by the Lord himself at the end of the Gospel of John. But yet, they were not ready to be a witness for him until they had received dynamite, is the word in English, dunamis power. That's the Greek word, dunamis. Dynamite power from on high to be a witness for him. So that's why all these preachers are not telling you the truth and not preaching the gospel, because they have not received power from on high. They're operating in their flesh. As I said in the last video I made, until you have experience, you can't teach somebody else something you don't know. The blind is leading the blind, brothers and sisters. They know about Jesus, but they don't know Jesus. There's a big difference, brothers and sisters. I would rather hear a person with a first grade education who's literally walked with the Lord and filled with his power than a guy with 10 PhDs who's the pastor of the First Presbyterian Church of the Dead in Christ in downtown New York City, or the firstborn dead of the, you know, Our Lady of Death Cathedral in New York City. Even he could be the Archbishop of Rome or whoever he may be, the Pope, whoever. I don't need to hear any high theologians, brothers and sisters. I need to hear a man who has met the risen Lord Jesus Christ and been filled with his Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. There's no greater power on this earth than the resurrection power. That's the same power that raised Christ from the dead, the apostle tells us. Apostle Paul tells us that the same power, this self-same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, can indwell you and be a river of living water flowing out of your belly. John chapter 7. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, when you get saved, you have that wellspring of living water in you. John chapter 4. But when you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, it's out of your belly would flow rivers of living water. Hallelujah. Many of you, it's so sad, and I'm ashamed that of people who are satisfied with a wellspring, a well of water, when they can have a river of living water, hallelujah, flowing out of them. They have this false sense of humility. And what it is, you don't want to serve God. You don't want to be close to God. You don't want to have all of God you can have. You want to hide behind your religion and keep your distance from the Lord. You want to be over here and be a Dead Sea Christian. You just want to receive and hide in the shadow. You've got your ticket punched. You know, you want to be on that train that's bound for glory. But hallelujah, you don't want to work on the train. You know, you don't want to be the driver on the train. You don't want to put coal in the engine of the train. You don't want to, you know, help other people get on the train. You just got yourself a seat and you sat down in the back of the train. But you know what? The Lord needs us to help other people get on the train, to be a conductor on the train, hallelujah, and help and assist others to get on that train that's bound for glory. Hallelujah. That's what the power of the Holy Spirit is about. Amen, brothers and sisters. Of course, it's not just about speaking with tongues. I want to say this. You know why God invented speaking in tongues? I'll tell you why. My personal opinion, and this is, I haven't heard a better reason other than through my own prayer and hearing from the Lord. It's because God chooses the simple things to confound the wise. The things of God is foolishness to those who are perishing. That's why God chose speaking in tongues, because you're not in control. Your little religious spirit and your little religious mind is not the boss. But God, the Holy Spirit, is the boss. And as His Spirit would give you utterance, you know, you surrender to God. You sing that song, you old denominational Pharisee saying, "I surrender all." No, you haven't. You surrendered just enough to get your ticket punched to enter the kingdom of heaven. But you haven't surrendered all to God. Because if you had surrendered all to God, you would stumble in, fall into the Holy Spirit. It's not a matter of studying and being a theologian and going through all these things. That's what I always say. I personally prayed with denominational preachers who've been pastors for 30, 40, 50 years, and they have the anointing of a dead person. No anointing at all. All this wisdom all up here and all of these cardinal-minded ways of understanding God, which we call theology. You know, man's study and trying to make God fit into the box of man-made wisdom. No anointing at all. You cannot tell me, brothers and sisters, and I've got, you know, testimonies of dozens of people from YouTube who I've talked to, people I know in the body of Christ. You can't tell me you've been a fervent prayer warrior and fervently seek God and hungered and thirst. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for you shall be filled." You can't tell me you've spent 40 years as a servant of God earnestly seeking God and seeking His wisdom and seeking His will in your life, and you didn't just stumble in as a two-year-old, stumble into the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And fall into the river of living water. There is no way, brothers and sisters, you can really know Jesus and really know the Father without knowing the Holy Spirit. Because they're all the same, brothers and sisters. All three are one and the same. What's got you bound is those lies of a religious spirit, brothers and sisters. Even listen to the lie that these old children of the devil tell. They'll say, "Oh, this, you know, new movement, it just started in 1907. You know, this charismatic movement, it came out of the Azusa Street Revival and all this stuff. All this new thing. They're not following our traditions. It's something new." Excuse me, old lying child of the devil. Don't you know that in the book of Acts, there's the original church, is the book of Acts. And in the book of Acts, chapter 2, we see on the day of Pentecost, chapter 2, verse 38, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, that the Holy Spirit, there came from heaven a sound like as a mighty rushing wind, and tongues of fire settled on their heads and on all their heads, and the Spirit of God moved on them, and they spoke in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And the people came and said, you know, and then let me just follow that text as the Lord is leading me, brothers and sisters. On the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, they began to speak in tongues. Acts chapter 2, verse 38, Peter said, "This is for you, your children, and all that are far off, as many as our Lord God shall call." He's talking about what the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for all that God would call. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. And don't say you're not called. If you're called to be saved, you're called to be a witness. You're called to be filled with this Holy Spirit. You can't be called to be saved and not called to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. All Christians should be baptized in the Holy Spirit. We are called to be endowed with power from on high. We're all called to be witnesses, to give a defense of the hope that lies within us, as the Word of God tells us. So later on, brothers and sisters, those people who make those videos and say, "Look at these Christians, you know, feel, you know, they're supposed to be speaking in tongues, and look at the way they're acting. They're acting like a bunch of crazy people," and they show those videos. And I see all those people who say they're Christians commenting on the bottom, "Look at these people, they're acting crazy. What's wrong with them? This is the devil, blah, blah, blah." For number one, they're blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And may God have mercy on their soul in their ignorance. And I pray that that text that Jesus said about blaspheming the Holy Spirit being an unforgivable sin, I hope that doesn't apply to that situation. Maybe it only applies to those who said that what Jesus did himself was blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. May God let that be so in Jesus' name, to have mercy on so many Holy Spirit blasphemers. But you know what happened, brothers and sisters? All you got to do is take off your religious blinders, throw out all them old devil things you've been taught, and go read your Bible. Your Bible. All these, especially your old Baptists, they love to keep talking about, they love the Word. Go read in the Word in Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2, brothers and sisters. Acts chapter 2. When the Holy Spirit had come on the apostles and the 120, and another lie that the devil's children says, only the apostles were baptized in the Holy Spirit. No, there were 120 people in the upper room. And no, it wasn't just on Pentecost. Acts chapter 19 in Ephesus, Gentile believers were baptized. In other parts of the Bible, in Samaria, Acts chapter 8, they were baptized in the Holy Spirit. Several more examples through the book of Acts. Anyway, brother says, there's another lie from the devil's children who just ignore the Bible, who just ignore the Word of God and make up their own rules. Brothers and sisters, it says that the people were mocking them and laughing at them. And Peter stood up, and what did Peter say? Hey, these people are not drunk as you suppose. They were drunk with the Holy Spirit, but not as you suppose. Why would Peter say, hey, these people aren't drunk as you suppose? Since this, you know, because the people were saying, hey, they're drunk on new wine. Peter said, oh, they're not drunk as you suppose because it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. That's what Peter said. So why would people say they were drunk? They were obviously acting foolishly in the eyes of people, because that's what they said. What Peter and the apostles, who these religious Holy Spirit blasphemer children of the devil claim that they believe the words of the apostles, they claim they believe the Bible is the inerrant Word of God, but yet when they see Pentecostals today on a video acting like they're drunk and maybe running around, jumping up and down, speaking in tongues and all, they say, look at this, this is crazy, this is the devil, these people are demon possessed. But yet that's the same thing that the apostles did on the day of Pentecost. So you tell me, how can you judge what's happening today? Is it because you old children of the devil, you old Pharisees, is it because something happened 2,000 years ago that automatically makes it holy? Is that why you know you love a hymnal? Because it's 200 or 300 years old and somehow that makes it holy? But if something's new, it can't be from God, it can't be holy, it's got to be 100 years old before I'll recognize it? I want to tell you two facts on that point. Number one, when the King James Bible was written, brothers and sisters, did you know that they purposely used words that were already traditions at that time? They did not use it in the speech that people used in 1611. They used it as the way people spoke in about 1550. You know why? Because religious people had an influence on the text, so let's make it more traditional words so that it will be considered more holy. One example. Second example. Brothers and sisters, in the times of London, when hymnals were created, there was an editorial talking about how this new fangled music, it's so wicked, it's from the devil, it goes against everything to do with Christianity. And there was an editorial on the hymnal style of worship, that it was evil and from the devil. Why? Because it was new, brothers and sisters, because it was new. And now that I think about it, brothers and sisters, as I'm hearing myself speak, myself, as this is coming from the Lord, I realize that the theme of my message is something new. God does something new. That's the theme of my message. And now I just got it myself. You know, I'm preaching to myself. Most of the time when I'm making videos, brothers and sisters, I'm hearing it just like you are. You know, it's just coming from that river of living water that was in me. And even the song that I was singing, see, I didn't even realize the connection. The song I'm singing, God Will Make a Way, which wasn't, I didn't even listen to that song today. You know, at this time, I was praying before I made this video. I wasn't even listening to that song or thinking about it. I'm not a huge Don Moen fan, as a matter of fact. But it says, God will make a way. You know, He will do something new today. That's what I was singing. That's that song. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works it out in His own way. He will make a way for me. He will make a way. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to come in agreement and pray with me with this oil, as I already did, that it be filled with God's power when it anoints people. Brothers and sisters, I had no plan to sell this oil. People have been donating for the orphanages and all of the ministry stuff, and I haven't been, you know, giving anybody anything. I wrote the book because the Lord led me to write the book. Some people have been making offerings and getting some of the books, a love offering. This oil, and I'm not hearing that from none of you, but I know how the devil's children think. It's not about selling some oil, brothers and sisters. It's a lot. Doing the oil is work for me. I have to prepare it, package it, all this stuff, go mail it and all that. People are already donating to Joshua's ministry and all that. Praise God, because it's for the work of the Lord. It's not a business thing. I just want to say that to you know, for any tares out there, and I don't even care what you think. God is, you know, kicking this thing up to a higher level because He wants to use this oil as a point of contact and a reference to prepare the bride. As a matter of fact, the Lord is just reminding me. You know, I mean, what does the text say? Those who have their oil. Now, of course, it's not this oil. Of course, He's talking about, you know, the ten virgins, the five wise and the five foolish, that they would have their oil. The oil represents the Holy Spirit. Now, there is a sister in the Lord. She knows who she is. She'll probably watch this video. Her father was a preacher, and she's been around the ministry for a long time. And her and I talked about this, and, you know, I made no video about it because I won't, you know, come out and say it as a dogmatic statement. But lots of people believe that what that text means is you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit in order to be raptured. Now, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that. But I will say this for those of you who have not been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Being baptized in the Holy Spirit gives you the power not only to be a witness, but it gives you a power to live a sanctified life. Now, if you really got saved, as I've said before, when you got really saved, you really had an encounter with God, the Holy Spirit. You know who the Holy Spirit is. You've experienced it like 10%. I will say that. Being saved is like experiencing the Holy Spirit 10%. Being baptized in the Holy Spirit is like 100%. So that's my scale. One-tenth. That wellspring of living water is one-tenth of the river of living water. Is being 100% or more, as God would overfill you and fill you and fill you and fill you and overflow you with His Holy Spirit and baptize you in it. Immerse you in His Holy Spirit. Submerge or emerge, whatever. Submerge you in His Holy Spirit. So this oil represents that, brothers and sisters. It's a representation, a point of contact of the Holy Spirit and God's Holy Spirit. And so we need, and I made lots of videos, and let me just say this, you know, just straight out. You know, we need to live a sanctified life to go in the rapture. I made a video that, for whatever reason, you know, God gave me to make it, and it's been viewed over 90,000 times. So, I mean, I haven't looked at it since I made it. I never, hardly ever watch my videos. But it's about, you know, the Lord showed me who would be raptured and who would be not. And obviously, I guess it's interesting to people because it's been seen over 90,000 times. But anyway, when I made that video, that's the time the Lord really moved me. Because I always, brothers and sisters, I always lean more towards, you know, of course, God's grace is, of course, is there. You know, and then the number one topic I make about is once saved, always saved, losing your salvation, all that kind of stuff. And I always, you know, try to lean toward more of once saved, always saved, even though, you know, there's a balance there. And I do believe it's possible to lose your salvation. My belief is basically that of what is of Assemblies of God. You can go research these different denominations. So Assemblies of God is basically, you know, has the same, you know, that's the beliefs that I have. That's why I went to school through their university, because that's basically my beliefs. I don't know if I agree with every single thing that anybody says, but they have a great doctrinal beliefs. If you want to have, you know, look at doctrinal beliefs of a denomination, Church of God, I guess, is basically about the same. Assemblies of God, Church of God, along in there, you're going to find this. But it's like this, brothers and sisters, and all my videos, is there are extremes in all things. There are extremes in all things. So there are extreme people who are extremely spooky spiritual and no grounding in the Word. As I made videos many times, brothers and sisters, there are people who try to calculate the rapture date and they have confirmation and every little thing and every little detail is just, you know, and it's just like they, you know, they live their life off of this, you know, someone's just, you know, just... random idea somebody has, they take it to be God's telling them to go move to India, you know. I've seen people like that. They'll just run with any little thing, and then they, you know, and what someone else said. It might not even be a Christian or whatever. And it's not like God said, hey, the Lord is telling me to tell you go to India. They're like, oh, somebody had a dream about Indiana Jones, so I think Indiana, I need to move to Indiana. Or maybe it's India, I need to move to India, where the movie was made, or whatever. I mean, whatever, you know, in a second. Some of those Indiana Jones movies, whatever. You know, there's people way out there, but yet the majority of people are on the other end where they don't think that God can speak to anybody. They don't know God is the great I am. They know Him as the great I was. That's another thing about religion. This video I made, God is the great I was, not the great I am. Now, I was just thinking right now as I'm talking, brothers and sisters, you can tell the difference when I'm speaking at a lower level than when I'm speaking when the Holy Spirit is really moving. You know, and that's my... you know, my personality. It's a real me talking right now, just me, myself. You know, of course, the Holy Spirit is still in me because, you know, the Holy Spirit is always with us. The Lord said he would never leave us nor forsake us. So he's always with us. But, you know, there's fillings of the Holy Spirit. There's all these different things you can learn, brothers and sisters. Lots of you know it. Some of you don't. Anyway, so, you know, a lot of you guys, you have no experience in this. God, there's different feelings. God can feel you to preach. He can feel you to pray for somebody. He can feel you, you know, to have grace to go through something that, you know, like someone's falsely accusing you. You get arrested. Someone accuses you of stealing something. You didn't do it. There you are. You pray. And then God just gives you grace and peace not to get mad and cuss everybody out, even though you've been falsely accused. You know, you see these people who are Christians and then they're in, you know, they're being persecuted in China or whatever, and you see them, they're like all cool, and you're like, what's up? How can they be cool through all this? It's because God has put, you know, a spirit of grace on them, spirit of peace to handle what's going on. I mean, that's how God operates. You know, if you've had any experience with God, you'll know that. He'll give you an anointing. And then for me, in my experience, especially in the prophetic, sometimes as I feel the Spirit of God moving in a certain way, and then I already know, whoops, you know, somebody's getting ready to die. Because I can feel that God is sending that peace that he sends when people die. I mean, it's true. So you can kind of guess, not saying that you sit there and, you know, I can just kind of have an idea. This seems to be what God's doing. Of course, no one knows the heart of God, but God, his ways are not our ways, the Bible says. You know, the heavens are above the earth, so is his ways above our ways. You know, God's ways are beyond finding out, the Bible says. So we don't know his ways. Anyway, you know, it's a mystery. It is really true. But anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, God bless you guys. There are some more things I want to talk about. I guess I should make a different video. You know, I always connect it together, you know, because I just want to put it out there in one sermon. But anyway, God bless you guys. I ask you to pray, continue to pray for the anointing oil. I've got about 10 already. Praise reports, people being healed and all this stuff. Even the brother Sid, you know, when he came here, he visited me because he's only about 15 minutes away. You know, we prayed together for the anointing oil. And then he had been having trouble with his hip. I anointed him. Prayed for him in his situation too. He needs to be moving pretty soon from the house he's in. He's getting, you know, he's praying about when he's going to leave, where he's going to go, and all this kind of stuff, you know, for what the Lord would have him do. And so we prayed together about that, and then we prayed for him to be healed. He says that, you know, he wrote in the comments too, he was healed. Other people too, Sister Carrie and other people. I don't want to start naming names because then I'll forget people. But I already did. Sorry about that. God bless you guys. You know that I love you. And so when, you know, someone watch my video and they hear me talking, they think, oh, you know, he's being mean or whatever. But it's, you know, it's Holy Spirit. People who are carnal minded, they don't recognize it sometimes. Some people do. They recognize the Holy Spirit. They have some experience with the Holy Spirit. So anyway, guys, God bless you. Be filled with his power. And I don't know why the Lord was showing me Brother Darren in Texas. But brother, you know, I believe that's what I told you is from the Lord. He wants you to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He wants you to be a witness for him. More, I know you already been doing it. I'm talking about in power, brother, not in what you've been doing, which is great. But the Lord wants to take you on in power, brother. When I say, you know, in my spirit, when I say power, I'm talking about the gifts of the Spirit, like laying hands on people to be healed and all that kind of stuff, brother. You know, and as a matter of fact, I believe, you know, from the Lord, you know, the Lord wants to let you operate in the gift of healing. And I'm speaking right now in Jesus' name. God wants to use you for healing, brother. And you need to be filled with on power from on high to do that. There's a power. Because it's a gift of the Holy Spirit. You have to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit to operate in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And God wants you to operate in the gift of healing. Brother Darren, it's a word for you. Sorry, you know, I can only give the word that the Lord would give me. You know, and that's the one he gave me, brother. For all the rest of you guys, lots of people have been asking me for a word. I can only give you a word when the Lord leads me, brothers and sisters. So praise God. You know, it's a new season. By the grace of God, maybe I'll be giving more words. You know, go back to doing those videos and giving people word. It's up to the Lord. God bless you guys. I love you guys. I need to make another video, and I'm going to separate it and make another one. Praise God.